We're going to be in the Word this morning, chapter 38 and 39 of the book of Genesis. Don't worry about 38. I'm just going to talk my way through it. Kim, thank you for having those scriptures up. Did want to talk about one quick thing. I got an anonymous note under my door couple weeks ago about, first of all, how good I'm doing. So thank you very much, whoever wrote it. And reminding me or informing me that the word suck or that sucks or whatever is based in apparently a pornographic background or reference to that. And so I did some research on that, and instead of being able to tell you directly, I don't know who you are, so I'm just going to say it publicly. I did quite a bit of research on it, and the end of the day, jury's really out on it, and it'll never be settled. However, there are and certainly going to be generational differences in how things are spoken, colloquialisms, differences of opinion. And the word that sucks or that sucks, it can be comes from a term, sucking hind tit. If you've never heard that, it comes from a farming expression or animal litter where the smallest little runt animal can't make its way up to nurse from mama well, so it's always pushed to back and sucks hind tit. And so we usually don't use that longer expression, and it was shortened for many to that sucks. There's always going to be people in the world who take anything at all and turning into something evil. Never underestimate the opportunity for people. And I grew up in the construction industry, and there's plenty, and the military, always opportunity to make something filthy out of everything. And while people do make things filthy out of many things, we're not going to do that. And I would remind you that at least since 1971, the word that sucks or to suck is dictionary definition meaning to be reprehensible and you know, something terrible, that's awful. And
you
so
put a quarter in missions every time you say it.
I don't want to be insulting to anyone, and I will not overuse the word if I can help it, and I certainly hope you're not offended by it. But it is pretty basic and coarse and vulgar. Vulgar from the point of view of it's not well-educated, put it that way. But it is going to happen from time to time, and I'm not going to say it to insult anybody or hurt your feelings, but just to say that that is a cultural phenomenon. For the last 46 years, it's been in the dictionary as something reprehensible. And if I have to wait another 50 years, I'll be 96 years old before I can start using it. So I'm just going to say that about that. By the way, it was pointed out to me by another pastor, not Pastor Sam, that things that whenever you have a fault or an issue with a brother, that Matthew 18 says that you're supposed to go to them and work it out. And that gives an opportunity to work it out in private. And so those things are supposed to be handled in the public or in the with the knowledge of a person one-on-one. However, whenever you're giving money, that you're supposed to like not let the right hand know what the left hand is doing. So in light of that, in the future, any notes, any criticisms, any concerns that are written that are not signed may not be considered at all in light of Matthew 18. However, any anonymous cash, that will be accepted in the spirit of the scriptures that says to accept it in that way. Now, I'm just being a little tongue-in-cheek about all that. If you write me a note, be honest with you, I can't help but look at it anyway, and I will prayerfully consider everything that's handed to me. But anyway, I just wanted to take a little minute on that. But anyway, thank you for whoever got me a glass of water. That's going to be a prophet's reward for that. What the word says. Let me get my glasses on here this morning, and these are probably some that actually Gary got me. We've had Gary's funeral this week, and it's been a emotionally tough week and busy one as well. But it's been a great time, good representation out by the church Thursday night. Thank you for that, and Wednesday morning. But we're going to miss him. Yeah. Moving forward this morning, though, in Genesis chapter 38. I'm not going through the scriptures verse by verse or even chapter by chapter, but really story by story. And so following Joseph being sold into slavery by his brothers, the next story in line comes up with a story about Judah. And one of the brothers, Judah, the oldest, second oldest brother, and how he ends up going to with a buddy of his that is not a Christian, if you will, and he hangs out in an area there where he hangs and finds a finds a daughter of the Canaanites, ends up marrying her, someone who's not in the faith, someone who he didn't follow in the pattern of his father and grandfather and go to a place that believed in Yahweh God, but rather a local deity-worshipping heathen woman, and marries her and has a couple of kids. And really, there's a lesson here in watch out who you marry and watch how you raise your children, because the first child did evil in the sight of the Lord. First man, actually, he was married off to a woman named Tamar, also from the region, not a godly woman as far as we know. And she, the first person, was killed. He did evil in the sight of the Lord. It doesn't say what. God's like, you're done. I'm killing you. Boom, you're over. I hear a lot of teaching in New Testament church today about God's not like that. He's not standing there with a big old stick, ready to beat you over the head, ready to destroy you. Well, in the Old Testament, he was, and it did from time to time. But in the age of grace, thank God, he's not waiting to whack us over the head and destroy us now. However, it should remind us that who we're dealing with. We're dealing with the all-powerful God who doesn't play around, and he is righteous and he is holy. And so the second son in line, which was normal in that culture to do, was supposed to go into the wife of the first widow and raise up children unto the brother, to go in and have a baby with the first wife, number one. And he didn't do a good job of that either, and that displeased the Lord, and so he killed him too. And so that's a very encouraging word this morning so far with that. And so then son number three is too young to marry. And so Judah says to the widow, says, just hang out in my house till my youngest son is old enough. And when he's old enough, we can bury him off to you and raise up children to your sons as well, your husband. And that doesn't happen, and he's a little slow about it, and so Tamar decides that she's going to take things in her own hands, takes off her widow's garment, puts on the garment of a harlot, and goes where he's going, and intercepts him. I guess she was successful in getting him to turn aside and share a little time, a few minutes, I guess, shall we say, and he left her, found out later that the story goes on to find out that, oh, wow, that Tamar's is now with child, and she has been playing the harlot. Let's burn her. I mean, let's just go straight from 0 to 100. Boom, right now, burn her. Never mind the fact that he was the one who impregnated her in the first place and had found a prostitute, which was there's just all kind of wrong in this whole story. Just the whole chapter. There's no redeeming value in it except to learn what not to do. And that's pretty much what that chapter is all about. And at the end of it, it caps it off with the most, I'd say, ridiculous of statements, where he says, she was more honorable than me. You know? Because, let's see, how does he put it? She was more righteous than I, because I did not give her Sheila, my son, and he never knew her again. You know, that's not saying much whenever you're saying that she was more righteous than me, whenever she became a prostitute and deceived, and, you know, it's just a mess. And so I decided to move on to the next chapter and see if there's anything better and more interesting, and it starts in with righteous Joseph. I'm like, finally, good, something to sink my teeth into. And then I realized as I studied the story that I think God put it in this order to show the difference between Judah and how he handled things with prostitution and deception and, you know, death by God and all kinds of things in there, and how it should be done by the righteous son, Joseph. And so I find that we move forward into Joseph's situation. And remember, when we left off, he had been put in a well, sold into slavery into Egypt, and that's where he was on his way to last time we looked. And then in chapter 39, verse 1, it says, "Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. Now the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian." Now, I just want to stop there for a moment, because there's a lot of discussion about success and success preaching and success. You know, what is the definition of success? Well, it's an interesting that Joseph's life kind of redefined what success is, because according to this biblical definition of success, Verse 2 says, the Lord was with Joseph and he was a successful man. You got to start with the fact, how old was Joseph? 17. So we're talking about purely teenage here. We're talking about somebody who was not very old, so he hadn't lived long enough to make much of a success in his life yet. But this definition of a success, according to the Bible here, 17 years old, double-crossed, hated by his brothers, enslaved in a foreign country, and the Lord was with him. You see, that last one trumps all the rest of them. You know, the definition of success in your life is not what kind of job you have, whether or not you're stuck in a no-win scenario, whether or not you're stuck in a situation that seems like there's no way out of. None of those things are considered success in this world. But if the Lord is with you, then that is considered success. Now, his brother, the story that was just told about here in the last chapter, Judah, I guess he was an arguable success. He owned a lot of sheep and cattle and kind of had servants that helped him and all this kind of wealth and everything. But the Bible does not call him a successful man, but rather he calls Joseph a successful man. He was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Just amazing that God is calling a successful man who is a slave, by the way. And then verse 3, it says, and his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. So now I want to talk about a definition of prosperity. Now let's look at prosperity. Now, what's the definition of prosperity? Be enslaved. And, you know, that it just doesn't seem to flow or follow what we would normally consider prosperity. But you see, prosperity in this case is this definition: slaves who work well for their master. Now, that's not the normal definition of prosperity. I know that. But this is the Bible's definition of prosperity in this case. He says that he prospered. He was a successful man. And that the Lord made him to prosper everything in his hand. So when he was doing things, he prospered, and the benefit of that prosperity did not go to himself, but rather to his master. So just because you're working yourself to death, and you say, I'm barely covering my bills, and all I'm doing is making that company owner rich, when am I going to get to be a success? I don't know. Is the Lord with you? If the Lord is with you, then you are prosperous and successful right now. Amen. If you do things as unto the Lord, then he will bless what you are doing, and he will make you prosperous. And the definition of that prosperity may be that that wealth goes to someone else, but God has something more in mind. Have you ever read the story before? I'll give you a little hint. Joseph ends up doing very, very well at the end. And then we find verse 4, Joseph found favor in his sight. Joseph found favor in his sight and served him and made him overseer of the house, and all that he had he put under his authority. So Joseph was successful, he was prosperous, and he found favor, and he was a slave. We really need to be careful about what we consider when we tell God about how we would like to prosper a little more, and how we'd like to be a little more successful, and how we'd like to see a little bit of favor. If you're not a slave, then you're doing better than Joseph right now. But if you don't have the Lord with you, then you are not doing anywhere near as well as him. Now, there's a few interesting little thing that goes along here, kind of a progressive thing. I'm going to look at verse 2, 3, and 4 again in order, because I underlined a few words here. The Lord, in verse 2, was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. Now, again, 17 years old, recently sold into slavery. His first job is a slave in the house. Now, he's not master over the house yet. He's just in the house. He's just a house boy. He's just doing whatever comes along. He's the low end of the totem pole. He's the new guy on the block. He's not anything that we would consider successful yet, but God called him successful. You see, God said he was a successful man. Now, is that how his dad treated him? As a matter of fact, yes. As a matter of fact, yes. Joseph, you could even say, was spoiled in his father's house. Joseph's father treated him well, put a robe on him, was his favorite son, youngest son, except for the baby. And he just loved Joseph and treated him well. So Joseph was successful at 17 with his first entry-level job as a slave, was already successful simply because that's what the Father and the Heavenly Father thought about him. Now think about yourself. If you are 17 years old or less, if you are at your first entry-level job, if you've proved nothing, if you know nothing, but your Heavenly Father thinks the world of you, then you are already a success. He was already a success. That's what the Scripture says. And then notice the next verse. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and so the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And so you see, who he was determined what he did. I don't believe that Joseph would have prospered in everything he did unless he first believed who he was. He believed that he was a successful man. The Scripture said he was a successful man. God said that he was a successful man. His own father told him he was a successful man and he hadn't done squat yet. Now, people who grew up on the wrong side of the tracks, people who had to raise themselves up by their own bootstraps, people who have tried really hard and are self-made men don't have a lot of respect for these guys. The little rich kid with a silver spoon in his mouth. But I'm here to tell you that Joseph and his character was not because Daddy was rich. It was because Daddy said you can be somebody. And fathers, you have a responsibility to tell your children that they can do it. Children, if you don't have a father that tells you that you can do it, then you need to believe what God says about you and not what the devil says about you. That you are already a screaming success at 17 years old. How many of you are 17 over here? 17-year-olds. Yeah, right, Pastor Pete. God thinks the world of 17-year-olds whose heart are his. And he says they are successful. And he says, and what he says about them and Joseph caused Joseph to do. And when he did, prosperity happened. Prosperity didn't come until he did. Now, who was the author of the prosperity? God was. But who held the key to the prosperity? Joseph did. When Joseph acted on what he believed about himself, he did a really good job at everything he touched, and God made sure that everything he did succeeded. So who gets the credit? God. Who unlocked it? Joseph. Why did Joseph unlock it? Because of what he believed about himself that the Father told him. And so he was a successful man. He did, everything he did was made to prosper in his hand. And in verse 4 it says, and Joseph found favor in his sight, the sight of his master, and served him. So did he court favor? Did he work for favor? No. You see, what he believed about himself caused him to do, and the prosperity of what he did caused favor to find him. And so who he was determined what he did, resulting in who he became. You see, because the rest of verse 4 said, when he found favor in Potiphar's sight, he served him, and Potiphar made him overseer of his house, and all that he had he put under his authority. So if you want to be promoted, if you wanted to move up in your job or in your authority or in your influence in life, you don't just sit around and shoot pock shots at the guy who got promoted and say, what a jerk, that must have been, they didn't deserve that. I mean, it must have been, I gotta be careful how I say this now, who were they kissing up to, you know, that they were promoted in this way? I don't wanna say something wrong here. So, yeah, So who were they sucking up to? Oh, I'm sorry. Did that? Uh-oh, Mickey, yep, quarter for the mission jar. All right, so he said he made him, but he was made overseer because favor found him. Favor found him because he had already been doing a good job. And he, when he did a good job, prosperity happened because of how he worked, because of who he believed he was. Do you see how this works? If you want to be elevated, then go believe who God made you to be. Then work like you are a child of God as unto the Lord, not as unto that boss. Because bosses will let you down. People will let you down. But when you do what you do, whether it's cleaning your room or whether it's cleaning out the deep fryer at work, at your McJob, whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord, believing that you are a child of the King and that you're going to do everything in a way that's going to bring prosperity to your hand, and favor will find you and promotion will come. Not because of what you did, but because of what the Father believed about you in the first place. What an awesome thing. It's such a totally different thing than what his brothers ended up doing. And then in verse 5 it says, "And so it was from that time that he had made him overseer of his house and all that he had, that Joseph blessed the Egyptian's house," "that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field." So Joseph ends up being over everything Potiphar has, not only his whole household, but all his land and all his holdings and everything he did. And everything that Joseph did, God blessed Joseph, and therefore Potiphar's house was also blessed. And when you go to your McJob and you believe who you are in Christ and you clean out that fryer grill to the best of your ability, God will bless you and promote you and cause more people to come and buy from McDonald's and get off I-95 and eat there so that you can have a job and get promoted. Does God care about promoting, fries and McJobs? Why? Because he's blessing everything that you touch because it's you. And if that happens to touch a job, then your job gets touched. If that job happens to be in a city called Titusville, then Titusville gets blessed as well. You see, God doesn't bless towns. God doesn't bless businesses. God blesses people. And the favor of God follows people. Favor looks for people to bless. And therefore, and then the result of that was that where you are favored, others around you are also favored as well. There's a sign on a church down the road here at the Assembly of God Church over on Highway 50 here. It says something to the effect of praying for God's blessings on Titusville. I'm like, yes, amen, brother. I pray for that every day with you. I agree with that. Because what's good for one of us is good for all of us. What's good for some of the economy in our town is good for all the economy in our town. What is good for righteous people to rule over us in part of the town is good for righteous people all over the town. See, we affect one another, and so we are interdependent on one another. And if you are the head and not the tail, if you are the leader and not the follower, if you are the one God blesses, then you will find that you are the one who are affecting others. You see, the fourth part of this story, who he was determined what he did, and that resulted in who he became, which ultimately resulted in who he affected for good. You see, whenever Joseph was affected for good, so was Potiphar, and when Potiphar's house was blessed, every servant in that house was blessed too. You see, when things are going bad at work, the bosses are mad, everybody's got to look busy, boss ain't happy. It's not a good time for anybody. But when things are good and the profits are coming in and the gift cards are coming out and the parties are coming and the celebrations are there and the Christmas party is more elaborate, you see, every time the business is blessed, the people have the potential of being blessed as well. And when you are blessed and you bless the world that you walk in, then that world blesses other people. That's how God uses you to bless the world. And so you can be that, or you can be the cynic that says, I got a raw deal in life. I was betrayed by my brothers. I was thrown in prison. I had no chance to do anything forward. I'm a slave. I have nothing. I'm hated by my brothers. And you can make excuses and do nothing. And you can be minimal and a minimalist. You know what a minimalist is? Someone who does the very least they can to be able to get by. I guarantee you that people who do the very least they can to get by are not the ones who are promoted or blessed in anything. And so they are overlooked for promotion. They are overlooked for blessing. But they become, so you have at that choice, at that point, two choices. One, to become like Joseph and begin to do things as unto the Lord, believing who you are in Christ and doing your best for God. Or start shooting at the people, not literally, that you hate, the ones that are promoted above you, the ones that are doing a good or a decent job. I can tell you this, the people shooting verbal insults and pock shots at others are not happy people. And it's funny how they get the ear of everybody in the office. Isn't it funny how they're the ones who get listened to? Isn't it funny how they appear to be the wise ones? I can see behind that. They know each other. They're family, I got to go leave early to pick up my kids from school, but they get to stay late and look great. They look so wise. But why? They are not wise. They're just wise guys. And those people who shoot down other people are themselves not happy. So don't look up to them and don't follow their ways. Don't emulate them. Don't do anything like them. Don't even hang around them because they will drag you down. You're probably going to end up being their boss anyway. So don't get too chummy. You got to stay in charge if you do things God's way. All right, so and then verse 6 it says, thus he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he did not know what he had except for the bread which he ate. Now Joseph was handsome in form and in appearance. Why not? He was the son of Rachel. Rachel was the good-looking wife, the one that his father Jacob wanted to marry. The good-looking, the one he went after, the one he loved. And so, of course, they make pretty children, and here's Joseph looking pretty. Another reason his brothers hated him, by the way. Yeah. So he was not only handsome, but he was in form. So he was physically built, apparently, as well as in appearance. He had a pretty face. And verse 7, it says, and it's just not fair, is it? Some people get everything. You know? Now, you can see Joseph at this point saying, Lord, couldn't be born, rich instead of so good-looking. You know, many times myself, got that same from my dad, you know. Now they're sweating, working on a job, trying to make ends meet, you know. So, where was I? All right, handsome in appearance, son of Rachel. By the way, I have a little bit of difficulty theologically defending this position, but I am of the opinion that the wife that Jacob wanted was Rachel. And all I can say is, poor Leah, for the number of reasons that she was poor Leah, and as much as God redeemed and blessed and felt sorry for her, her kids turned out terrible. But Rachel's turned out to be Joseph. And I don't know what that means, but I do know it does mean this. It means a couple things. One is, how you raise your kids is very important in how they turn out. How you personally believe about yourself is very important. And as my wife pointed out to me, when you are loved, you pass on love. When you are in a loving environment and you are treated right as a wife, then you are letting that overflow onto your children. When you're in a loving relationship with your spouse and you find that that is a good and a right relationship, it cannot help but pour out to be a good relationship in a situation on your children. Now, not all of us have that opportunity to grow up in that environment, so God can bless you despite that, which Joseph is a good example in this horrible story he had to walk through. But wherever you find yourself in life, God can bring you through it, but how you raise your children often results in how they turn out. Now, if you've got a child that just turns out to be a hellion, and you've done the right thing, that's not on you. So don't beat yourself up about that. You can't help that. Jacob had 12 sons. Only one or two of them maybe turned out to be worth bragging about. But here we are in verse 7. It says, "And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast longing eyes on him, and she said, 'Lie with me.'" Now I like a direct woman, but that's a little too direct. I guess Joseph wasn't getting the hint. Lie with me. Let's just get to the point here. I don't think she was sleepy. Verse 8, but he refused. But he refused. But he refused. Well, there, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm messing with you guys. Missions budget is going to be right on target today. All right. Anyway. Verse 7 still, it said, "Lie with me." In verse 8, but he refused and said to his master's wife, let me get to that in just a moment. First of all, he refused. This is key to Joseph's success. Not that he refused this sexual advance. That's just part of the story. The secret to his success is that he chose well. Now, was Joseph responsible for his success and the blessings and prosperity that followed him? Was he ultimately responsible for that, or did that come from God? It came from God because of his close relationship with God and what God believed about him. So we can credit that all of that was God's favor. But what did Joseph bring to the table? What did the rich kid with a spoon, silver spoon in his mouth, bring to the table? He brought his integrity that affected his choices. He was a man of integrity, and when that integrity was tried, he made a choice that caused success for him and blessing on others for generations ultimately. And so what do we bring to the table? Our good looks and talent? Do we bring everything? God is the author of all those things in our lives, right? He's the one who blesses us, right? Not we ourselves. So what do we bring? What we bring is our choice. We bring our choice. Now, Joseph was not a moral and righteous and awesome person just because he inherently was born that way, because he was born in sin just like every one of us since Adam. Well, Adam wasn't born in sin. That was the whole point, I guess, of the fall. But you know what I'm saying, right? None of us are doing well. But what made Joseph distinct wasn't that he was somehow the golden child, like Daddy said. Not that he was somehow better than others, but because Joseph made right choices when they mattered. We can all emulate that. And so he made the right choice when it was the right time. And so he refused and said to his master's wife, "Look." And I had to look that up in the Hebrew. It's like, does that really mean like, now look? It really does mean look. And, well, interrogatively, it means like just what it means in English. Now look. But it also means look at what I'm about to tell you. He says, "Look at this. My master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. There is no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" A couple things there. First of all, she could not see that his success, the source of his success, was in his integrity. She could not see that if she got what she wanted, she wouldn't really want it after all. You see, that's the problem with adultery. It's whenever you finally get who you're going after, you find out that they because you get them, they have lost integrity. And so they're no longer the shining thing that you perhaps wanted. What was so great about that person may not be so great once you get them. And she could not understand nor see that this shining beacon, this hunk of a man who was in charge of everything, oh, he's handsome, he's young, he's got a great body, my husband's out of town and he's in charge. She didn't understand that when she took away his integrity, he would lose all the luster that he had in that place and would become just another scumbag who did the wrong thing and would have lost that integrity. And so he says, look, this is how this works. This is why this is what it is. I cannot do this great wickedness and sin against Potiphar. Oh, that's right. It doesn't say against Potiphar, does it? Now, it would have been a sin against Potiphar, and he was just talking about that. But he carries it out by saying, I cannot do this sin against God. Because that's where his integrity was. That's where his heart was that he was a man of integrity who would not do the wrong against God. Now, again, I'm just so impressed by Joseph because he was such the little, you know, the baby of the family is always the one who gets away with murder, right? He's the one who's like everybody rolls their eyes at, you know. He's the one who gets away with everything and the silver spoon in the mouth, the whole bit. And yet when push came to shove, his integrity showed his character. His decision showed his character and integrity. Surely you're not clicking because it's 5 till. No, I get 12 minutes still, baby. We're good. There is, so he says, I'll not do this great wickedness. I just want to look at Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4 right here. It brings up this first one. It says, I know you got it on the screen there, but I like to look at my scriptures here. It says, marriage is honorable among all, and the bed is undefiled. But fornicators and adulterers God will judge. That's what he means by this great offense. He says adultery is still a sin. Now, had the Ten Commandments been given at this point? Nope. Did he already know that adultery was wrong without a Ten Commandments to tell him so? Yes, he knew. He knew that it was wrong. And so it says God would judge that. And so he says, no, I'm not going to do this great evil. And so if we look on back to the passage and look on in verse Genesis chapter 39 and verse 10, it says, so it was that as she spoke to Joseph day by day, that he did not heed her to lie with her or to be with her. Now, I want to look at a couple scriptures there. Psalm 84, verses 10 and 11. Go ahead and put it up there. Psalm 84, it starts at verse 8, it says, O Lord of hosts, hear my prayer. Give hear, O God of Jacob, Selah. O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God or a slave in Potiphar's house than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Now I added that part in there, of course, myself. Go to verse 11. I didn't give you 11. Well, it's a good thing I got it here. It says, Psalm 84, 10 and 11 says, For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory, and no good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Now, the rest of all that stuff we read there is to just kind of set up how good God is, and as an evidence to say that last phrase again, no good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Another passage says that the blessings of the Lord are good and he adds no sorrow with it. Why did he keep saying no and no and no and no again? Because he had faith in God. And if God wanted him to have a little honey there, that he would give him one. If God wanted to have a wife, he wouldn't have had to bring Potiphar's wife along. God did not give him Potiphar's wife. God did not give him a wife yet. And so he believed that if he did the right thing, that the blessings of God would come on him in due time and bring those things to pass. And so the next thing I want to show in that passage, verse 10 of Genesis, says, so it was when he spoke to Joseph that day that he did not heed her to lie with her, or to be with her. I want to look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 3 and this one. You see, because we're not supposed to risk emotional attachment either. It says, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you as is fitting for the saints. If there were rumors about that Pastor Steve was a womanizer, would that be good for our church? No. No, it wouldn't. Who said yeah? Nobody said, somebody said something. No, it would not. Why? Because reputation affects all of us, right? And so Paul's very careful to say, hey, don't let that stuff even be named among you. Don't let it even be named among you that that kind of stuff is put up with. In other words, let's live our lives above board in such a way that not only are you doing the right thing, but anybody looking on is pretty sure that you're also doing the right thing. Now, people get stuff wrong. The very fact happened to Joseph. You know, he was accused of doing something he didn't really do. But you see, it said the way he Joseph handled the situation back in Genesis 39:10, it says, so it was when she spoke to Joseph day by day that he did not heed to her to lie with her, nor to be with her. Well, okay, so don't lie with me. Just come in and hang out with me a little bit. Sit down, Joseph. Talk to me. Just come on. Let's just spend a little time together. Why? No. Why? Because you're not my wife. That's why. Because if you and I just become friends, friendships can lead to more. Now, I don't want to be unfriendly, and I consider myself too friend of a lot of women in this church and in the world around me. But there are always appropriations that married people do with members of the opposite sex. We have friendships with many people in the church. Many of them are men, many of them are women, but there's not too many close buddy women friends that I have. Why is that? For the appropriate reasons that chumminess and familiarity can breed more problems down the road. You see, whenever you hang around someone a little too much, might notice that they sure are friendly. Boy, they sure are there for me whenever times are tough. Boy, they're just so understanding. Man, those hugs are just so warm, and it just doesn't mean anything, but boy, it's just so nice. You know, boy, they really understand when I talk. My wife, my husband doesn't have time for me, but you know, that person, boy, they really listen. You know, watch out for those traps. Not too many affairs in churches, and they do happen. Start out with lie with me. That ain't how it starts. It starts with, you look nice today. Now, is there anything wrong with saying you look nice today? And if you hear me say it later, okay, I'm not coming on to you, all right? But everything begins innocent until it's not. And so Joseph knew that, and he said not only did he not lie with her, but he did not get alone with her either. Try to never be alone with members of the opposite sex if they're not your family, if you're not your wife. Right? Just try not to. Now, is it going to happen? Occasionally things happen. Okay, but if you live a lifestyle of not being known for not doing those things, then you are likely not going to fall into the traps of either being judged by the outside world that you're doing something wrong, nor yourself being likely to fall into that as well. Let me move forward. And then verse 11 says, but it happened about this time when Joseph went into the house to do the work, and none of the men of the house was inside. Watch out. I'm sure she put them out, by the way. That she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. Back to the direct approach. But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside. He did exactly what the Bible teaches to do in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Got verses through 15 through 20. It says, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you are bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Now right center of that passage of Scripture tells you how to handle sexual temptation. Flee.
Flee.
Flee. Flee don't mean bug. Flee means run. Now, flee doesn't mean, well, tell you what, this is getting a little uncomfortable. I think I'm just gonna go. I'm just have to move on out here. Or hey, don't be doing that with me because you're looking mighty good, and you know you keep that up, and who knows what might happen. Once you start talking about it, once you say I'm attracted to you, but I'm trying not to be, it's over, folks. You are on a slippery slope at the point you start telling someone who is not your wife or husband that you are attracted to them, but I'm just telling you so we can pray about this, sister. Run! Flee! Beat feet! Get out of that situation as fast as you can. People who are running are either running for their lives or they look like idiots. Look like an idiot if you need to, but you get yourself out of that situation. You flee from that situation, no matter what that looks like. It's too important for yourself and for that person. So he fled and ran outside, verse 12. And so it was when he saw he left his garment in her hand, she fled outside. And that he had fled outside, that she called the men of the house and spoke to them, saying, he has brought into us a Hebrew to mock us. He who? Oh, it's my husband's fault. He, my husband, has brought into this house a Hebrew to mock us. Oh, so now we're going to go racial. Oh, so she uses racism to unify the men with her against the other man. You see, because the men of the house had things pretty sweet. When Joseph was in charge, things were going good. Because he was a righteous man and a successful man, things were going good for all the men of that house. How is she going to turn the men of the house against him? They're all men. She a woman. She's fighting an uphill battle. He's their boss. Things are going good for him. How does she divide them? Racial lines. We're Egyptians. He's a Hebrew. Now, I may be female, you guys might be male, but he is an outsider. And they divided him on racial lines. Very interesting there. And so it happened, verse 15, that when he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, that he left his garment with me and fled outside. So she kept his garment with her until the master came home. Then she spoke to him the words like these, saying, the Hebrew servant whom you brought to us came in to me to mock me. And so it happened, as I lifted up my voice and cried out, that he left his garment with me and fled outside. And so it was, when his master heard the words, when his wife spoke to him, saying, your servant did this to me in this manner, that his anger was aroused. I want to look at the last verse outside of this text here at Proverbs chapter 6, verse 34, coming up next. And it says, for jealousy is a husband's fury. Therefore, he will not spare in the day of vengeance. He will accept no recompense, nor will he be appeased, though you give many gifts. We kind of look at Potiphar like, hey, are you an idiot? Did you not know your wife was like that? But you see, a jealous husband is a jealous husband. Two warnings there. If you're messing around with somebody's wife, there's a jealous husband. Watch out, because he's not going to act normally. Somebody will need to hold him back. Some crime is going to be committed on you. So accept no recompense. And so now, while Joseph didn't do anything wrong, it's understandable how Potiphar acted. Then verse 20 says, then Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in prison. You see, because no good deed will go unpunished. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy. Because mercy is what he needed right then. Showed him mercy, because God does the work. And God gave him favor in the sight of the innkeeper, of the keeper of the prison. God's still the author. God's still the author of blessing. He's still the source. All Joseph had to do was the right thing. Joseph controlled his choices and those alone, and God looked after the rest. And so the innkeeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever they did there, it was his doing. And the keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper. Joseph's demotion was God's preparation. Joseph went through a lot of trouble. He was sold into slavery, thrown into a pit, sold as a slave and humiliated. Rose through the ranks, things look like they're turning around, only to be falsely accused, humiliated again, and then thrown into prison again, only to be blessed again because God was using every experience of young Joseph's life to prepare him for what was coming next week. God, you may feel like that you have tried to do the right thing and all hell has broken loose in your life anyway. You might feel like this really doesn't work after all. I'm throwing in the towel. I'm going to try something different. God loves me and he's pretty good, but he's kind of an old doddering father that's got to go out and got to run the universe, but this ain't happening in my life. I'm going to take things into my own hands. Don't do it. God knows where you are. Even if you get demoted because you were falsely accused, that what looks like a demotion is God's preparation for the next phase of your life that you cannot see. I was delighted and horrified this morning to find out that Joel Osteen was preaching my message. I turn him on Sunday mornings. I come out sometimes, and he's always so positive. He builds me up, you know how he is. But he was talking about Joseph again as well. He said it this way, that God showed him a promise to begin with, and it ended up really well, but God is the God of the middle. Remember that God is the God of the middle. And in the middle times, what is our job when things are going to hell in a handbasket? Make good choices. Keep God close.